fiscal year 2021 earnings call. Present with me today are my colleagues Vineet Harlalka, Mr. Rajesh Mediratta, Amit Kumar, Sang Gautam, Samir Prakash, Deepak Mehta, Indraneel Chatterjee, Shruti Bhatia, and Aparna Garg. Our Chairman and Managing Director, Mr. S.N. Goyal, is unable to join us today. He had been keeping little unwell and is now recovering. Amidst the surging COVID pandemic, I sincerely hope you all, your colleagues, your families have been keeping safe, healthy, and cautious. The second wave has affected us in so many ways. Our wishes for everyone, well-being, good health, and speedy recovery. It has been almost a year since we have been confronting the COVID-19 pandemic. Its harsh realities have impacted many of us, besides marking dent on the economy, industry, as well as life as such. The second wave of the pandemic poses some risk and might offset some of the economic gains made in the last few quarters. The fiscal year 2021 has had its own share of ups and downs. As we face the hardships caused by the pandemic, the macroeconomic growth indicator dipped to unforeseen levels. The energy and power sector have not been an exception. The first two quarters were difficult. However, the last two quarters have seen good growth momentum led by resilience on the economic and industrial activities front. In fact, in both Q3 and Q4, IEX achieved the highest quarterly volume ever traded at the platform. During the fiscal year 2021, we made significant contribution towards supporting the economic and industrial revival through our robust business continuity plan. It ensured round-the-clock access to our trading platform and facilitated the distribution utilities with uninterrupted access to most competitively priced electricity in the most flexible, transparent, and reliable manner, thereby helping them accrue financial savings as well as improve their financial liquidity. Besides the launch of new market segments, the real-time market as well as green market, this added much-needed vibrancy and dynamism to the market, providing great choices in terms of product offering to the market participants. As our nation prepares to revive the economic growth, we are confident of playing a key role in establishing an efficient energy order and supporting India's transition to building a sustainable energy economy. Technology and innovation are the key cornerstones of our vision to build energy markets. As a technology-led marketplace, we strive to integrate innovative technologies at both the trading and the enterprise IT levels to provide an intuitive, seamless, customer-centric, and best-in-class solutions to the market participants. Fiscal year 2021 has been an exceptional year for us in our journey of the last 12 plus years. We can say that the year was characterized by digital transformation comprising several initiatives welcomed on technology and customer centricity. Our key role in the energy ecosystem, robust digital and technology infrastructure, growing and diverse market segments, and seamless market operation and services have helped us deliver success in these challenging times. During the year, we strengthened and advanced technology, expanded IEX product portfolio with the commencement of new market segments, such as green market and real-time markets, and also diversified our play within the energy sector with entry into gas trading through India's first authorized gas exchange, which is IGX, Indian Gas Exchange. The Indian Gas Exchange has subsequently onboarded several eminent strategic partners such as NSE, ONGC, GAIL, Adani Total Gas, and Torrent Gas as key stakeholders. Our sectoral partners have a strong play in both upstream and downstream segments of the gas sector, while NSE, a global market leader with rich legacy, expertise, and experience in conducting operations at a large scale, should help IGX play a key role in developing India as a market-based gas economy. With the market participants warming up to the idea of competitive price gas and several key policy and regulatory initiatives, we expect trade to grow at a faster pace in the coming months. Additionally, during the year, IGX also signed a licensing agreement with Multi-Commodity Exchange of India, MCX. Under the MCX, will launch electricity derivatives in the country, using IEX price as a reference price. Of course, this is subject to approval from government and the regulators. Throughout the year, we engaged with customers through the outreach and capacity building efforts through series of workshops and webinars focused on electricity market, green market, as well as the gas markets. To build momentum in the gas market, we introduced an open auction format and also several market-friendly features, which has been received very well by the market participants. In February 2021, the CA laid down the much-awaited procedure for approval and facilitation of cross-border trade of electricity, and we are pleased to inform that on 17th April 2021, we pioneered commencement of the cross-border electricity trade on exchange. In the mid to long term, our endeavor is to build a vibrant and integrated South Asian regional power market. Nepal is the first country to have participated in the day-ahead market on exchange, and Nepal has since been trading almost on a daily basis. The trading volumes are likely to increase going forward. We also continue our proactive efforts to bring other grid connected South Asian countries such as Bangladesh and Bhutan. Simultaneously, we have also been doing the groundwork to advance our technology platform to support the lineup of upcoming new segments that include long duration delivery contracts and the integrated green day ahead market. Our efforts are on these fronts, and invaluable support from our members, clients, partners, and employees have helped us navigate safely through the challenging times during the last 1 year. Continued encouragement and support from all our stakeholders has been key to delivering a great success, and we continue to be optimistic about the future growth trajectory. I will now share with you overall economic and industry update and how it played out for our business. The industrial and economic activities and thereby electricity consumption reduced over 23% during the initial month of fiscal year 2021, primarily due to nationwide lockdowns. In the subsequent months, with the relaxation in the restriction, manufacturing PMI that had dipped to the historic level of -57.3 in April 2020 rebounded to +58.9, the highest over the last 8 years. The industrial activity decelerated a bit in Q4 compared to Q3 FY21. However, it remained above 50. This has been a good sign so far and indicates the resilience and recovery of the Indian economy. With the recovery in the economic activities, electricity demand and consumption improved. The electricity consumption had dropped by 23% in April 20 and remained negative for first two quarters. The phenomenal rebound was seen in Q3 FY21. In Q4 FY21, electricity consumption increased by 8.9% YOY. The national peak demand also met highest level of 189 gigawatt in the fiscal year 2021. As of March 2021, the installed power capacity at 382 gigawatt saw 3.3% YOY growth. The renewable energy capacity saw 9% YOY growth, with cumulative renewable capacity now at 94 gigawatt from an earlier 87 gigawatt in the fiscal year 2020. This considerable growth in green power reiterates the fast-paced energy shift that has been underway and an increased emphasis on building a sustainable and decarbonized energy economy. During the fiscal year 2021, IEX witnessed increased participation from the market participants, given its robust value proposition of most competitive price, besides the flexibility, transparency, and no counterparty risk in the power procurement. This was also reflected in the increase in share of exchanges in the short-term power market, which has increased from 40% in the fiscal year 2020 to 54% in the fiscal year 2021. This is a significant jump of 14% in just 1 year. Most importantly, power exchanges now contribute about 6% of the electricity consumed in the country. This was 4.4% in the last fiscal 2020. Therefore, the exchange market has seen accelerated pace of growth in the last fiscal year. On the policy and regulatory front, the government introduced many futuristic initiatives to support the revival of power sector, with an objective to revive the viability of the distribution segment, especially from the perspective of DISCOM's financial health. The Power Ministry came up with the Electricity Amendment Bill 2020, proposing amendments to the Electricity Act 2003 with an aim to unleash distribution reforms such as de-licensing of distribution business and facilitating competition in the power distribution and supply. This was followed by FM's announcement in the Union Budget 2021-22 to introduce revamped reforms-based result-linked power distribution sector scheme. This is set to be launched with an outlay of rupees 3 lakh crores over 5 years. further to encourage better efficiency through increased competition within the distribution segment, government will introduce electricity connections portability while giving consumers the power of choice. In December, the Ministry of Power also introduced a proposal enabling the distribution utility to exit the power purchase agreement after completion of the term of agreement. This initiative will accelerate utility procurement besides increased sale of power by the generators on the exchange platform. Another key development from consumer perspective was notification of electricity rights of consumer rules 2020. This was a significant step that aimed at streamlining and enhancing the quality of electricity supply and services being provided to consumers across the country. More recently, the government has also issued the draft National Electricity Policy 2021, which underlines the most pertinent issues of power sector with key focus on areas such as promotion of clean and sustainable generation of electricity, development of adequate and efficient transmission system, revitalization of distribution utility, as well as the development of efficient power market through an increased role of markets, aiming at market to represent 25% share by FY24. The Ministry of Power also issued a paper on development of integrated daily day-ahead market in power exchange with separate price formation for RE and conventional power. Some of the important regulatory initiatives to deepen the power market were PRC Power Market Regulation 2021, which allows introduction of electricity contracts beyond 11 days, notification of procedure on cross-border electricity trade, merit order dispatch and power purchase optimization regulations by some state regulators. On the gas market front, PNGRB introduced the gas exchange regulation in September 2020. Another important step that would help the development of gas market was the simplification of the pipeline tariff structure by PNGRB. The two-zone tariff structure, which led to a reduction in the transmission charges for distant user of natural gas, thereby making it more conducive for trade on gas market. PNGRB has also notified final regulation regarding access code of CGD entities post-exclusivity period, wherein 20% of the pipeline network will be available for open access. Another important development was PNGRB notifying the imbalance management service regulation. These developments together will help increase competitiveness in the market and increase the consumption of natural gas in the country. On a standalone basis, now I'll talk about financial and business performance. On a standalone basis, revenue for the quarter grew by 28.3% YOY from rupees 79.4 crore in Q4 FY20 to rupees 101.8 crore in Q4 FY21. This largely attributed to an 41% increase in transaction revenue. For the fiscal year 2021, this growth was 20.3% YOY with revenue at 357.4 crores for the year. Q4 FY21 saw the highest ever electricity volume growth of 62% YOY during quarter. Also, fiscal 2021 saw the highest ever yearly volume of 73.9 billion units traded at the exchange since 2008, since inception, resulting in a growth of 37.3% in electricity segment on year-on-year basis. The growth was driven by the competitive power prices, creating traction with the distribution utilities as well as industrial consumers, growing consumption of electricity, availability of adequate domestic coal, and that too at a competitive price, along with the commencement of new and much-awaited market segments such as the real-time market and green market. The day-ahead market saw an average market clearing price of ₹2.82 in the fiscal year 2021, which is about 6% lower than the previous year price. Low power prices and ample sell-side liquidity throughout the year helped the distribution utilities and industrial consumers to optimize their power procurement and maintain good financial liquidity amidst the COVID crisis. The real-time electricity market commenced trading on 1st June 2020 and has received an incredible response from all the market participants. The market crossed 1 BU mark for 4 consecutive months, that is from December 2020 to March 2020. In fact, in March 2021, it saw the highest ever monthly volume of 1.4 billion units on a cumulative basis. In Q4 FY21, the market traded 3766 million units. Since its commencement, the market has traded 9.5 billion units. We introduced another important market segment this year, green turn-ahead market, to support and accelerate India's transition to a sustainable energy economy. The market commenced trading on 21st August 2020 and has cumulatively traded 785 million units since commencement. In Q4, the market traded 238 million units volume across both solar and non-solar segments. As per the April order, the stay in REC trading has been continuing since June 2020. During the fiscal year, the REC market could only cumulatively trade 6.97 lakh units. This has been a damper for the exchange market during the otherwise exceptional financial year. Talking about way forward, fiscal year 2021 was a year of splendid success and growth for us. The year started in a turbulent way. However, demand resilience and positive sentiments in the last two quarters assisted economic revival and recovery in a significant way. While we are now going through and experience a second and a much harsher pandemic wave, our experience to deal with challenges, undaunted spirit, and collective efforts will ensure victory in this battle. The localized restrictions and lockdowns may impact economic growth to some extent. However, the industry and commercial ecosystem seems to be well prepared this time as compared to last year, and consumption seems to be stable. Going to the current situation, while RBI expects that the GDP will grow at 10.5% in this fiscal, the industry experts have started coming out with revised estimates ranging between 10 to 12%. Taking all this into account and looking at the growth momentum IEX achieved in fiscal year 2021, we would endeavor to maintain double-digit CAGR growth track that we have achieved over the last 5 years. Overall, we expect the demand to register a robust growth during the next year, too, on account of economic revival. Further, conducive policy and regulatory regime, besides increasing power demand and consumption, adequate availability of domestic coal, and phasing out of old and inefficient plants will serve as a key growth levers for us. Additionally, the much-awaited launch of two market segments, longer duration delivery contracts up to 365 days, integrated green day-ahead market, commencement of derivative trading on commodity exchanges, and focus on diversification will unleash growth for us. In fiscal 2021, we made considerable investments to strengthen and advance our technology. We will continue the momentum in this fiscal too. Our endeavor is to make IEX a best-in-the-class technology platform. By FY22, we will see fruits of past investments and our continuing efforts and investment towards technology innovation and automation. Some new initiatives that our market participants will experience are provisioning of data insights, APIs, adoption of advanced MILP algorithm, and most importantly, our web-based trading portal, which we have recently launched on April 28th, will make the trading experience seamless and far more intuitive for our participants. Coming to the new product launches, we have already marked the beginning of this year with launch of cross-border electricity trade. We expect to create greater momentum as we engage in the capacity building and create awareness among the stakeholders. After Nepal, we expect countries such as Bhutan and Bangladesh to join soon. We are also working to introduce longer duration delivery contracts up to 365 days in both electricity and green markets. Another market segment that we expect to launch is integrated green day-ahead market. Once functional, this will allow greater revenues for renewable power sellers and buyers to trade renewable power. We will continue to work in collaboration with the government, customers, and other stakeholders to develop the energy markets. As we move forward with confidence and certainty in this otherwise an uncertain year, we firmly believe that the energy markets play a key role in transforming the sector. IEX is committed to playing a proactive role in facilitating the much-needed efficiency, competitiveness, and sustainability in the energy ecosystem. Thank you. Over to you, Sumit.
Rituja, we can open for questions.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles.
Rohit, while the question queue assembles, I have a question. know, what is your take on the resumption of trading in REC? When do you see that happening? And what is your take on the status of new product launches, particularly LDC, and the timing of that in FY22?
Yeah. Rajesh, sir, you are there? Yeah, so to answer your first question, which is about resumption of REC trade. See, we were, in fact, Aptel has given multiple dates in the month of April where they wanted to do hearing on continuous basis. Initially, they came up with the 3 dates in the month of April, and they wanted to do it on a fast-track basis so that in a month or so time, the resumption can be, the REC trading can be resumed. But now the recent development is on the last date of hearing, which was 28th, because of COVID situation again, the new date given by them is July 14th, which is again 3 months away. So this is a little bit setback, I would say, because we were expecting it to start somewhere later in the Q1 itself, but now it will surely go to Q2. So resumption will not happen till Q2. But since REC is one segment where you have to fulfill your obligation on annual basis, and since last year it was not, trading didn't happen, so all the RPO has been carried forward to this particular year, and even we might start a little late, but as and when it will start, all the participants, both distribution company as well as consumer, they will try to fulfill their entire past obligation, which is for FY20 also, FY21 also, and FY22 also. So though it is being pushed a little because of this pandemic situation, but we are hopeful that by Q2 and it must start. So similar is the case with e-service market, energy saving certificates, because we were expecting it to start somewhere in Q3 FY21, but for again on similar reasons because of pandemic, it also got pushed. So same for energy saving certificates, we are expecting it to start getting somewhere in the Q2 FY22. So that was your first part. Can you please repeat your second part of the question?
Yes, I mean, I asked about the status on the new product launches and when, particularly LDC, when can we expect it to happen this year? And what volume to expect in this market?
Okay. So LDC is another segment which we are very excited about. And here we have already filed petition with CRC. Yeah, this we filed about 6 months back, long time since we have filed it. But only thing which is blocking introduction of this new product is the settlement has happened between the two regulators, which is SEBI and CRC. But they have to withdraw case from Supreme Court, decade long case which is pending there in the Supreme Court. They have to withdraw that. And once that is withdrawn, our petition will be taken up for hearing, and then we will get approval. So our expectation is after the Supreme Court withdrawal, we expect 2 to 3 months for the purpose of launching this new contract, which is longer duration contract. So suppose this happens somewhere in end of Q1 or early Q2. So by Q2 end or early Q3, we should be in a position to launch this particular product. So from our side, technology readiness is there. Petition we have already filed. So nothing is stopping us from this. The only thing is the regulatory bottlenecks are there, which is taking a little more time. It is taking a little more time than our expectation. That's one. You also asked about volume. So here, on annual basis, about 25 to 30 billion units are traded under this particular forward contract platform. Today, most of these transactions are done through the platform. We expect, if we go by the similar volume, 30 BU potential is there in this particular segment. And depending on our launch in current fiscal, we would like to capture some of that volume.
Yeah, thank you, Rohit. I was on mute, so I could not take question, but you covered very well. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thanks.
Rituja, please take the question from the line.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Navneet Kumar from TN Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Yeah, please go ahead.
I'm audible. This is I'm Mohit Kumar, DM Capital. Sir, a few questions, sir. How far are we in terms of readiness for launching green day ahead market contracts? And secondly, where do you think RTM volumes can stabilize as a percentage of total electricity volumes? While we had a very, very good year, FY21, but how far it can go up as a percentage of total electricity volumes in short to medium terms?
So, Mohit, I'll try to answer second question first, and then Rajesh sir can take up the first one. So, your question is about RTM volume, and what we have seen last year, RTM volume total, which was available only for 10 months, this particular product was available for 10 months, did about 13%. Its contribution was 13% in our total electricity volume. But if you see Q4 particularly, Q4, which was very good, in fact, very exceptional for us in volume terms, a contribution of real-time market was close to 17.5%. So it is picking up really well. We are seeing increased participation coming from almost all the segments, which includes distribution utilities as well as open access consumers. So what is happening here is some of the distribution utilities, they are dividing their total requirement in two baskets. So one is the firm thing which they are coming to day-ahead market, which is absolute essential, which they want to do. And then where there is some 10-20% some mismatches there, where they have some doubts whether this sort of demand would be there or not, that part they are keeping for real-time market. So this is one reason. And in fact, in the month of April, the same trend continued. April, we again witnessed more than 1 billion unit, and in fact, highest ever monthly volume was recorded in the month of April. So difficult to put number to it, because we have seen consistent growth there. But I won't be surprised if this starts to do somewhere between 20-25% also in let's say a few quarters from now. Then I won't be surprised. So if I have answered your question.
Yeah, for the first part, Mohit, GDAM is like something which we have been pursuing long with CERC. Earlier, we had applied for GDAM, but it was rejected in 2018. But now again, the ministry is very keen to launch this GDAM market. And already paper was issued, and paper sets the target of deadline of June 30th. The only thing is, we don't expect CERC to clear our application by June 30th. We have already filed our application last month. So we are waiting for approval of GDAM from CERC, and post approval, we will be ready to launch this. So as soon as approval by CERC, we are ready for launch with the GDAM. So maybe quarter two of this year, we should expect this market to come in.
Yes. Understood, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Gokul Maheshwari from Abhiga Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for taking my question. RTM market has done really well for us, and the market share gains have come from largely the bilateral market and not from the DSM. So could you just comment on how can we really capture more share from the DSM market? Second question is on the REC, this thing. Just wanted to reconfirm that the customer segment will have to make up for the FY21 volumes as well. So if you could just confirm that as well. Thank you.
Yeah, so for REC segment, yes, they have to make up for the FY21 volume as well, because this RPO calculation is done on annual basis in most of the cases. And in certain cases, carry forward is allowed. In some other cases, it is not allowed. But then there was no option available. You have to make up for that in the subsequent year. So most of that will get converted into FY22. Now, to answer your first part, which is about RTM. So there is no shifting which has happened from bilateral market to RTM. No, because these are two very different time frames. These market operates in very different time frame. When we talk about bilateral market, it is normally 1 month and beyond, right? So when those who are participating in real-time market, they are doing it on the basis of their balancing requirement, their correction in forecasting where they have gone wrong on day-ahead basis, that correction they do in the RTM market. So no relation between the two. But as far as DSM is concerned, a lot of shifting has happened. So if you see absolute number of DSM, you will not find major change there. But if we do some deep analysis of DSM number, we have seen that a lot of quantum has shifted from DSM to this. What happens in DSM is when you are overdrawing from grid, there are various slabs where suppose you are drawing more than 12%, then there is a 20% slab penalty which is applicable. Up to 12%, nothing is applicable. You have to purely pay on the basis of DSM prices. And suppose you are going beyond 15%, then 40% is applicable, and after that, 100% penalty is applicable. So what we have seen in most of the cases, there are certain states which are overdrawing. Their penalty portion, the quantum they were overdrawing and paying high penalty, that has gone down. So that quantum has shifted to RTM market. I can quote some more examples. We have seen in many cases where all of a sudden there is a shift, there is a tripping of one big state plant. So we have seen in case of many states, particularly Chhattisgarh, 2-3 times, all of a sudden there one plant which was running at 600 megawatt got tripped for some reason. And this state was participating in RTM in a very big way. So for the to make up for the loss which has happened on account of this plant going off bar, they had no other option but to come to RTM market. So had this market not been there, they would have been dependent on DSM market. Their DSM, they would have paid very high penalty by overdrawing from grid. So as per our analysis, a lot of shifting has happened. Only thing is, absolute number has not gone down. To the extent there is no penalty available, states are still drawing, and which is right also. There is no harm in that. As long as you are paying pure normal DSM prices, it is okay to overdraw to that limit.
Okay. And lastly, just on the dividend, your payout, I mean, the company sitting on around 600 crores of cash. Could you just comment on your dividend payout policy, especially given that investments are largely done with the IGX as well, and there are no major capital investments? So is there a firm dividend payout policy?
I would request Vineet to take up this, please.
Yeah, thanks, Roy. I'd like to inform that we have a dividend policy, and as per the dividend policy, the company does to ensure that 50% of the profit should be distributed in the form of dividend. And keeping in that line, in the January itself, just in the last quarter, the company paid a dividend of 250%, 2.5 rupees per share. And considering that, because this time, because of the COVID uncertainty, the dividend was not declared. And but definitely it was on the start. So when we go with our annual report to the shareholder to the HM, definitely we make this in dividend portion. Regarding the 600 crore line of funds, you will see the exchange business is a bit of different business. So there's a lot of companies get the deposits on the funds. So those funds are lined with the company. If you look at the overall shareholders fund, that fund will not be that significant in comparison to the overall business. And company invested the money in the IGX, and they're also exploring a lot of other opportunities because the way the platform market and the way the sector is booming. So we are definitely looking at it, and at the whatever the call the boards and the management team, they will take the ultimate for the whatever the value, the best value interest of the stakeholders.
Great, great. Thank you so much, and stay safe.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. The next question is from the line of Devansh Nigotia from SINPL. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity and congratulations on a very good set of numbers. Sir, just one re-clarification on LDC and derivatives contract. So in the interview today, we expressed that there was a positive development. But currently you highlighted that the matter has been settled, but the case has not been withdrawn. So I'm just not able to understand what has really changed here from the past.
So nothing changed in last quarter or last few months, I would say. See, what we are saying is the settlement has happened. Now, both there is absolute clarity amongst both the regulators, which is SEBI and CERC in this particular case. They have drawn line what falls under whose jurisdiction. Only thing is this settlement has to be vetted by the court, because this is pending in Supreme Court for almost 10 years now. So this is very close to resolution now. Only thing is they have to file one joint application for withdrawal, which they have already filed. But the problem is, for some reason, because of COVID, only very pressing matters are being taken up at Supreme Court level. So very in the past, we have seen many dates were given, and for some reason, all those dates were, the hearing didn't happen on that date. It is just one hearing away from Supreme Court, where the final order will come and the settlement done by the regulators and ministries will be acknowledged and will be authorized. So nothing changed. Only thing is, we are waiting for Supreme Court to come out with the order so that the doors can be opened and the finally these contracts can be launched.
Okay. And in case of green turmoil market, I mean, there has been an increase in the momentum recently. So is it because that the summers are there, which keeps the liquidity in from the side of the generator on a higher side? So is there some seasonal effect or something has changed structurally here?
Yes. So it's a combination of both the things. We have not many sellers today who are actively participating here. And some of the state utilities are also there. So some southern state utilities are actively participating, and their own demand has gone down. So when their own demand has gone down a little, they have huge surplus quantum which they want to sell, and they are bidding that at our platform. That is number one. And second important thing is, when we launched this market in August 20. So August 20 is normally a time when your wind season is over. In India, we have wind generation starts to peak in somewhere in May, and it peaks somewhere in June, July, August, and after that it increases again. So last time we could not take advantage of wind season, because by the time we launched this contract, not enough wind generation was there. This time we are rightly placed, and initial 5-6 months this volume should be very high, because solar, which is largely available throughout the year, wind is something which is available only mostly in batch one. So that is another reason why we are seeing some traction.
Okay, and amongst the generators who are not tied up with PPAs, what is the percentage of the generators we are able to tap on the exchange currently for trading of GTAM, and you know, and what are the constraints for the generators who we are not able to tap and who are still not tied up with the PPA?
So for all the renewable plants, you will find that all the renewable generators, they have some sort of arrangement with either with the consumers or with the distribution company, where they are supplying under certain terms and conditions. So most of these are under long-term PPA, which is up to 25 years. But there are many small generators where they have small quantum PPAs with the consumers, with the C&I segment, particularly for 1 year or so. So today we have seen participation of over 10 generators at our platform already, where they have participated, and whatever surplus quantum they had, they have started. And in fact, there are 2-3 opportunities for us. One opportunity is where they have tie-up, very short-term tie-up. There are many where they have tie-up of 1-3 years. So we are targeting those generators, because here the realization is pretty good and they can explore this option as well. That is one. Second is, there is another set of generators where, as per the PPA terms, they have to maintain certain utilization factors in a year. So that sometimes what happens is, now particularly because of newer technologies, because of some good year where your generation is little more, they exceed those US numbers. So what we are trying to tell them is, when they are going beyond their PPA commitment, they can also come to this platform and start selling their surplus power, and thereby realizing the market prices that are there. But large part of the transactions which are happening today, here the sellers are distribution company. There are many distribution companies in the country today, those who have surplus. There are states like Karnataka, which is surplus in both solar as well as non-solar. AP is surplus in both solar and non-solar. Telangana is surplus in solar. Tamil Nadu is surplus in non-solar. Gujarat is surplus in one of the two. Similarly, Rajasthan is also surplus. So many distribution companies are there who are surplus, and we are trying to get them on board so that the side liquidity can be maintained. And on the buy side, there is no dearth of demand, because since REC trading is not happening, most of these buyers, they are willing to buy green energy itself for the purpose of meeting their RPO, and prices are also quite decent, very competitive price power is available.
And sir, in case of cross-border, the existing volume that we highlighted was 18.07 billion units in FY21. So what percentage would be up to 11 days and 11 days to 1 year, and 1 year and above? So the 18 billion units that you mentioned, the opportunity size of?
No, 18 billion units there's never an opportunity size for CBET. You're talking about cross-border trade, right?
Yes, cross-border, yes. Yes.
Yeah, so cross-border trade that we have started recently, about a month back, where we have seen participation from just one entity, which is Nepal. And participation has been quite decent. Some days we have seen overall participation going up to 5% of our day-ahead market. And it is ever increasing as far as they are meeting their requirement depending on their demand-supply situation. All this quantum that we are talking about is in the spot market. Today, only their participation is allowed only in spot market. So whatever number that we are sharing, and it is for sure not BUs, it must be million units. All this is coming from spot market because that's the only place where this transaction has started. So nothing beyond 7 days, nothing up to 365 days. Those are separate contracts. Those are separate bilateral contracts which are going on, which has been going on for a long, long time. So today what we are saying when CBET has started, it has started purely from the point of view of their participation at our exchange plan.
So we are the one to start the spot volumes, if that's the right understanding in cross-border as of now.
Absolutely.
Okay. Now, thanks a lot. Okay. Thanks a lot, sir. That was really nice.
Thank you.
So let me add what Gohit said, because if you see when we started exchange, there was nothing up to a week volume or up to a day. So everything started with the converting bilaterals into day-ahead and other markets. So this is what will happen. Some part of the volume which is currently happening in bilateral, which is a month or a one-year contract, that part will may shift to day-ahead market. Because people would like to, all the our neighboring countries would like to transact at a competitively discovered price. And in bilateral, they are not comfortable because the price is never... they are not comfortable with the prices because whether it's competitive enough or not, always that apprehension is there. So we hope that currently what is happening in bilateral, a part of that will shift to day-ahead. So there is nothing which is currently happening on day-ahead or the week-ahead basis, but what is happening on a monthly or yearly, that will shift to day-ahead.
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Okay.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Kunal Tanvi from Banyan Tree Advisors. Please go ahead.
Hey, hi. Thanks, Rohit, for the opportunity and congratulations on both set of numbers. So my question was again on the DSM market. So you know, you had highlighted in the previous participant question that we are seeing a shift in terms, you know, because what I remember that, you know, we launched RTM as a product to make sure that there is a shift from DSM to the RTM. And you also highlighted that we are already seeing that, you know, shift. However, when you look at the absolute numbers, you know, don't see that at all, right? You're continuing to see DSM volumes to be there where it were. In fact, they are, as in your presentation, you had highlighted they are 1% up from last year, right? On a 9-month comparison basis. So then it doesn't tie up. Whereas when you look at the bilateral market, there you see a significant drop in the volumes. So how should one look at this? Because at the end of the day, looking at the overall limit, slab, everything, it has to, the DSM volumes need to go down if we are getting some share from there, right? How should one read into it?
See, as I explained earlier also, within the DSM thing, you have multiple slabs. I won't go into the same detail again. But what I was trying to tell you was, sometimes what happens is when all of a sudden you have got huge imbalance available, because this could happen because of some tripping, this could happen because of some renewable intermittency, all of a sudden wind generation going up or down. So what the options were available to you was, it was only grid, right? You can start to draw more, or second option available to distribution company was load shedding. So suppose all of a sudden 600 megawatt supply gap is there, so immediately you will shut down certain feeders to make up for that loss. So now what has happened with RTM being in place, first of all, that load shedding is not happening because now you have options available where you can immediately come to the market and start buying. And second thing which I said was, where you were attracting, where your overdraw was attracting huge penalty, right? So this quantum was not very high. This quantum was not very high because when they used to watch that 100% penalty is being imposed, they used to take certain some decisions of load shedding and other things at their end. So what has happened is,
his question is still not being answered. What he says, finally the numbers should reflect the shift, but numbers are not reflecting the shift. But what I can add to the understanding is that with the increased renewables coming into system, probably if nothing, no RTM or other options are not available, would not have been available, probably that time the DSM should have increased. Mm-hmm. So what has not increased is actually coming to the real-time market. And so that can be explained like this, because as we are going into higher renewable regime, then intermittency and more deviations are likely to take place, which is not being reflected. It means that deviations otherwise, which is would have happened, are actually coming to the real-time market.
Absolutely.
Sure. And also on the, you know, in one of the call, you know, last time around, we had discussed this point about, you know, the price at which the penalties are being levied is, you know, not a block price and a day average price.
Yes.
Anything of that you can share, like what will happen to the, you know, DSM market if there is a change in the, you know, regulation regarding the price that is benchmarked for the DSM?
I think that there is no discussion today happening. But of course, if it will be more rational if we are linking prices, the DSM prices, with the time block wise prices.
Yeah.
But currently, discussion is not taking place, and we have also not raised this issue because we are also not very confident to what extent this will impact volume. But we will do our own analysis and then pursue with the CERC.
Just to add here, Rajesh sir, when this regulation came somewhere in 2017 or 18, that time they mentioned very clearly that in a year's time, so they are starting this on pilot basis, and within a year's time, they will migrate from RTC average price to time block wise price. So it was mentioned there in that particular regulation, but for some reason they have not taken it up, and we have seen increased grid discipline after that. So today, frequency is not changing much, and you will most of the time find frequency in the narrow band of whatever they have designed. So that way, but that's an excellent point, because going forward, if that has to happen, then surely we will see some more conversion from DSM market to RTM market.
Yeah, and this is, I think, rightly raised, because we also missed it, and maybe we
Sure. And sorry, I also missed on the dividend policy part. You had mentioned that, you know, we have a policy of 50% profits as payout, right? However, this year that payout looks, you know, lower than 50%. You did explain something with the annual general meeting notice, but I missed on that. Can you repeat that again, please?
Yeah,
You are rightly said the company has the policy of paying at least 50% of their profits as a dividend. And in line with that, in the month of January, we paid the interim dividend of 50%, 2.5 rupees. So there was a cash outflow of almost 175 crores. And because of this month, because of the high-end this COVID situation, so we have not declared the final dividend. Looking at the overall position, then we declared the AGM notice, and at that time, definitely we will consider and announce the dividend. How much I can't comment because that is a board prerogative that we look into. So definitely the fee will definitely still consider it.
Sure. Thanks. I'll get back in this. Thank you so much. All the best.
Thank you.
Request to the participants, in order to ensure that the management is able to address questions from all participants, please limit your question to 2 per participant. If you have a follow-up question, you may rejoin the queue. The next question is from the line of Swarnil Maheshwari from Edelweiss. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hello, sir. Good evening, and thanks for the opportunity. Sir, 2 set of questions. First one on the day-ahead market. Now, I believe we will be launching the LDC market somewhere by December. Now, if you see that the demand has basically kind of softened a bit, and it is likely to be there in the low teens for the next 2 or 3 months. And this has also impacted our the volumes for day-ahead market. What we also see is that there is some sort of a revival in the short-term PPAs. So my question over here is that can the DEM volumes be under some pressure from say Q1 to Q3 till the time we don't launch the LDC product? That's my first question.
Yeah. So. See, DAM requirement, DAM market is there to fulfill certain set of requirements for the market participants. So these distribution companies, they analyze their supply, they analyze their cost of supply availability on day ahead basis. On that basis, wherever is the deficit, wherever they want to replace or optimize, they participate at our plant, they participate in our day ahead platform and meet that requirement. So I don't agree with this that since the softening of demand has happened, so our volume would be under pressure. I can recall last year in the month of May, volume was down, overall demand was down 15% YOY. But that was the month where we registered 40% growth in our volume. So it's not purely related to demand. And in fact, if you see H1 also last year or Q3 also, their demand has not picked up so, and our volume were doing great in particular day-ahead market. So what happens is there is a day-ahead market is used for the purpose of meeting deficit. So if you have shortages, you come to market. And second important thing is when the cheap power is available in the day-ahead market, many distribution companies today, they start to back down their own generation and come to this market to optimize on their power cost. Similarly, if the prices are down, there is ample availability in the market, we see a lot of C&I participation increasing. And when the prices are down, they're breaking and their viability increases and they participate. So no reason for us to believe that going forward, for Q, let's say next quarter 1, 2, 3, we are expecting day-ahead market to be under pressure. LDC is a different segment altogether. So we do have bilateral market, which has been functional for so many years. In fact, it started much before exchange, and this has been doing decent volume year on year. As I said, there is about 25-13 billion unit potential which is available, and we are in the process of launching this market to capture that. So it's not that we are expecting some shift from here to there. Both the markets are independent market, and this is as per the global standard. Globally also, you will find there is market available for different time frame. Market is available for annual buy, quarterly buy, monthly buy, day-ahead buy, real-time buy. All these markets are as per the standard design, which has been adopted by almost most of the countries globally.
That's a fair point. My limited understanding was that we are unlikely to go back to 200 million units but per day kind of volume that we saw in Q4 specifically. That was my limited point. Because the demand has softened and then there is a revival of short-term PPAs also. So that was my limited point. And hence, in isolation, on absolute basis, the DAM volumes will be strong. But maybe since we have a base effect also, I was talking more from that perspective. So that's it. So the second question is on IGX actually. So we have actually, you know, almost sold the now closer to 45% stake, and there is actually no price discovery. And we appreciate the fact that this was on account of that to fend off the competition clearly. Just wanted to understand the next 30% where we have to actually get to about 75%. We have to bring it down. So in that next 30%, when is this expected to take place? And importantly, can we expect this 30% stake sale to be at premium to the face value?
Yeah, very right. Actually, we have divested about 46-47%, and we don't intend to sell this further 30% in near future. So we still have to take a call that when we will be doing it and at what premium that will be done. So I can't say anything on that because the board will take a call. But that overall this investment is not going to happen beyond this 50% anytime soon. So currently what is there, maybe next small this investment can happen to one of the strategic investor, which can happen maybe in a month or so. But beyond that, we are not looking for any further disinvestment, and the premium we will fix as we go along.
Yeah, correct. Because the next 25%, we have got a long window of about 4 to 5 years.
Yeah. We have 4 years' time, so that we will decide when to do that.
If you see the stake sale, what was done was from the strategic point of view. So it was not the intention of just giving the equity to someone, to the counselor, or the investor. And so company had done it to chip in the big players of the drug sector in this. And going forward, we see, as Mr. Mandrapa has said, except one or two of the key significant players, if they are willing to take, there is no intention to divest further till the mandatory regulatory requirement is there to bring our stake to 25%. So we should be giving the comfort enough to the investors to understand the structure.
Oh, fair enough, sir. Got it. Thank you so much and wish you all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abhilasha Satale from Dalal & Broacha. Please go ahead.
Thank you for taking my question. So my first question is towards the CERC's order, like CERC's approval for the new exchange. So this is like Pranurja, which is in offering. So what is update on that, and where are we placed if whenever that exchange is coming on stream? So this is my first question.
Yeah. So very recently there was order from CERC where registration has been approved by them, and now what we understand is they have to file business rules, and they also have to share their technology platform with CERC and obtain approval. So that's the status. And as far as we are concerned, we have been maintaining always that we welcome competition. So what we feel is it is just a start. We are just doing 6% as exchanges. We are doing only 6%. Two exchanges are there for so long time, and we have to go a long way. Our focus should be on evolving right market designs. There is a lot which is to be done. In fact, if you go by a National Electricity Policy Draft 1, which has been released by government very recently, it talks about exchanges contributing 25% in the total consumption by FY24. So if those are our targets, and if you want to go beyond that, if you want to route the entire generation through exchange, and if you want to use exchanges for the purpose of renewable capacity addition, if you have plans for CFDs, and all these are things are being considered at various levels in the government and by the regulators and everybody. So if those are things which is to be done, we always believe that competition is required. It will eventually help the end consumers. They will have more competitive power, which would be available. As a exchange, we would be able to do some more innovation, create more customer-centric products, and everybody will gain out of that competition.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. And sir, after approval, like, what is likely timeline for the actual, the launch of the exchange? Like, what it is according to you?
Difficult to say. It depends on individual company. But one thing is clear, what I mentioned, 3 months time has been given by CERC for the purpose of obtaining these approvals. They have to file. And beyond that, we are not aware of how much time they will take. But developing technology, and since now so many new products are there, it is a constant continual improvement basis. We have to do so many things as far as technology is concerned. So it is not so easy thing. You have to invest time, you have to invest money to get all those things in place.
Rohit, there was a media story which said that they are expected by year end. So that is what you can take it because it must be some statement from that Pranurja, which has been recorded in the media story. So they are expecting to start operations by year end.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, yeah, sure. And secondly, sir, my other question is on GTAM. So you mentioned about the, you know, TAM, GTAM volume, from where the volumes are coming. When, you know, we are launching GTAM, wherein, as you mentioned, most of the green energy is with PPAs, like, you know, the PPAs are already signed for the whatever the power plants are coming. So from where, like, what kind of opportunity we are seeing in that product, say GTAM, like how much volumes, you know, we are seeing over a longer period of time coming up through green energy?
I'll share one example. See, when we started exchange in 2008, that time there was no concept of merchant generators. So except for one odd IPP where they had no tie up available, they were selling at exchange. Otherwise, entire capacity in the country was tied up under long-term PPA. Now, if you see today, over the years, what has happened? Today, we have got 30 gigawatt of merchant capacity available in the country where there are no tie-ups. People are investing in the projects where they want to create capacity, which is solely dependent on the market. They participate in bilateral market, they participate in the spot market, and try to maximize their revenue. So this is what we have seen, and it has its own phases. So initially, some of the IPPs, they started keeping just 15% power for market, remaining 85%, they preferred long-term PPAs. And same thing is or will happen in renewable as well. So today, as I said, there are not many generators where they have tie-up, but there are many generators where their PPAs are coming to an end. There are many generators who are following, who are watching these prices, those who are taking reference of these prices, and then they are planning to create some capacity only for supply under merchant route within mid to short term. So what we do is, first we create marketplace. Whatever is available in the market will come to the market, and then market will start giving signals to all the people who are willing to make investments in the sector and take position and try to create capacity and sell. Jai sir, you want to add something more here?
No. You have covered very well.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, sure. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Varun Goenka from Nippon Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yes, good afternoon, Rohit and Ayush's team. Congratulations for a fantastic performance.
Thank you.
You guys have been delivering for over 10 years now. So, very credible. I think you've answered it in very good detail. Thank you so much. You mentioned a few technology initiatives. If you could lay down some details as to what you have done in FY21, what are the key initiatives and implementations in FY22? How is it? What is it solving at your end, and what is it solving at the customer's end? It would be really good to hear. Yeah.
Yeah, Amit, would you like to answer this?
Yeah, sure.
Yes.
Good afternoon, everyone. So, regarding the technology initiatives that we have taken in the current in the last financial year, so some of the key ones. One is that we launched automated bidding option for the customers through the application programming interface. So with the launch of real time market, where the customers had to do bidding 48 times during the day, it was important to drive the growth and adoption of real-time market to provide customers with an option to integrate their systems directly with our systems through our API so that the whole bidding process can be automated. And that is something we launched right from day one of the launch of the real-time market. And some of our large members are already integrated to this automated API bidding solutions. And almost close to 60-70% of the cleared volume in real-time market actually is for the bids that gets placed through the automated API bidding model. So that is one of the options that we did. The second option was to continuously, from a product and technology perspective, we are innovating and identifying how we can make the whole process seamless and easy for customers to interact with the with our exchange platform. So with that objective, we also looked at an opportunity wherein we can provide customers with an option of auto forwarding their uncleared bids of day ahead market into term ahead market. So for example, as we know that once the day ahead market ends, post that, customers have an option of placing uncleared bids into the day-ahead contingency market. And the existing process was that if there is uncleared bid, then they have to then create the bid for placing in the day-ahead contingency market and place that bid manually. So we built a solution which was an option of automating this whole carry forward of an unclear day-ahead market bid into a day-ahead contingency market, and if it doesn't get cleared in the day-ahead contingency, it gets carried forward to the intraday market. So customer had that option to take up that option as well. So those are one or two examples of solutions that we provided, which eases the bidding experience for the customers. Then, in addition to that, we also introduced some of enhancements that enables easy view of the existing bids. So for that, we introduced a dynamic market watch functionality in the term ahead market, which enabled customers a very, very easy view of the active bids which are present in the market, so that based on that, for the continuous matching products, looking at the dynamic market watch, they can plan to put in bids and be at the right prices to do the matching. So that is another example of a customer facing initiative that really helps the customers. In addition to that, we have built in a lot of automation of some of the existing processes, which helps us provide a much more faster outcome to the customers. One of the examples being we have done automated integration with our clearing banks, which now enables us to provide payment credit even 3 to 4 hours faster than what we used to do earlier. So which means that we are earlier on, most of the time the credit used to happen in the second half, and now we are able to do that credit in the first half itself, so that customers who want to utilize that money to invest in the funds or any activity, like there are a lot of afternoon funds which are afternoon cutoffs, they have the money in the morning for them to use it for the investment and other working capital needs. So these are some of the examples of automation that we have done and technology that we have used to enhance the customer experience. And so that is from a customer perspective. And then there are a lot of process automation that we have done within our internal company process, which makes our company internal processes much more effective. We have done a SAP rollout within the organization, which makes a lot of internal processes much more effective. There are a lot of business process automation that we have done, which makes the whole market operations processes, through which we provide the registration and the scheduling and the clearing settlement facilities to the customers, that becomes much more effective. And very recently, we have launched the web-based platform for our customers. So one of the key initiatives that we are also working on is to provide all our existing platform features through a web-based platform to the customers, and also going forward to a mobile-based platform. So we have in the last week of April launched a web-based features platform to the customers. So that is something that we have done till now. Going forward, some of the key things that we are going to do is extension of the web-based platform to provide bidding for all the products through the web-based platform itself, and also introduction of a mobile-based platform, which will provide a lot of deep data insights, and also going forward provide the bidding option to the customers. So that is one important thing that we are in the current financial year going to work on providing. Second, I mentioned about the auto carry forward between day-ahead and day-ahead contingency. We are, with the success of that auto carry forward functionality, we are working on building a auto carry forward integrated pipeline for all the different product segments, so that customers would have the option of using the auto carry forward functionality to carry forward. Like, to just to give example, suppose a customer wants that a bid placed in the existing green term ahead market, if it doesn't get cleared, let's say it's a sell bid, it should automatically move to the real time market. So similarly, we have identified all the different auto carry forward flow, and we are building a pipeline which provides a option to the customers to utilize that feature to ease the whole bidding process. So these are some of the initiatives that we are working upon in this financial year, and in the subsequent quarterly earnings call, we'll keep you updated about what we have done and what more we plan to do from transforming customer experience using technology or product.
Thank you so much, Rohit. Always great to hear you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, due to time constraints, that was the last question for today. I would now like to hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
Yeah, thanks. So, thank you so much for attending this. We value your time. Today is a holiday for some of us, and still we could do it. Thank you so much. We expect you to stay safe, be cautious. This is just a passing phase. All of us together will surely win. And thanks from the management team. Thank you from all of us here to all the participants. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone. Thanks. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
On behalf of Axis Capital Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your line.
Bye.
Perfect.